this is the next thing is a hypokalemia. So we have seen hypocalcemia. The next thing is hypophosphatemia. In phosphorus, we are using only inorganic phosphorus. And within 2 or 3 days, if you are giving the correct dosage, IV with oral administration, excellent efficacy will be there. The other thing is the potassium. Hypokalemia, low potassium level in the serum is another one important component. In this session, I will tell you how to use this potassium judiciously, because many of us may not be knowing how to use the potassium judiciously. And after this session, I hope you can use it very safely. So like this type of cases, you might have attended hypocalcemia cases, or you might have treated any case of Downer cow with the calcium, but it is not, but it is urinating, defecating is there, everything is there, but it is not getting up. The animal is in the sternal recumbency or lateral recumbency. Still it is healthy. You have supplemented phosphorus also, but it is not getting up. So animal is like this means you have to think about hypokalemia. The etiology, indiscriminate use of isoflurpiridone. Many of us will be using isoflurpiridone in the field practice indiscriminately. That is one of the predisposing cause for hypokalemia. For example, a mastitis case is that. So in order to avoid a reduction in the milk yield, you will be thinking that we can use isoflurane so that the swelling will be reduced and also milk yield cannot be affected. Like that, you will be preferring isoflurpiridone. So when you are giving isoflurpiridone for 2 or 3 days continuously, that will lead to depletion of potassium. And prolonged anorexia, that is also another one of the important etiology for hypokalemia. And lack of water or hay during the heavy lactation period, or depletion of potassium. So these are the main, many of the gastrointestinal disorders also, there will be depletion of potassium. That will also lead to secondary hypokalemia. And the animal will be exhibiting signs of recumbency. As I already told, many of the GA obstructions, many of the GA disorders, potassium will be depleted. So you have to take care in supplementing potassium. And also potassium is lost in the milk also. Like calcium, potassium is excreted in the milk also. 1.4 gram of potassium is excreted through the milk in 1 liter of milk. That you have to take care. That means you have to supplement potassium. And hyperinsulinemia secondary to hyperglycemia. So that means the transcellular shift of potassium to the extracellular fluid body. For example, whenever the hyperkalemia, in hyperkalemia for small animals and all, the treatment of hyperkalemia itself, the treatment that includes dextrose solutions. So when you give excess amount of dextrose, hypertonic dextrose solutions, that may also lead to transient hypokalemia. So also, whenever you are giving dextrose D20, D25, whenever it is not warranted, when you are giving the rapid infusion, 1 liter, 1.5 liter, that will lead to depletion of phosphorus also. So transient hypophosphatemia will be occurring when you are administering this one, dextrose solution, that you have to take care. So you should not give D20 or D25 in not needed cases. So you should not give 1 liter, 1.5 liter, whenever it is not necessary, you should not give. When you are giving this in excess, that will lead to depletion of phosphorus and potassium also. Then other things, as we already told, this acidemia increases the potassium concentration, as in the DCAD we have discussed. And the hypokalemia occurs commonly in ruminants with the metabolic alkalosis. And there is no homeostasis, like calcium, parathyroid and calcitonin are involved. Is there no for homeostasis, maintaining the calcium level in the blood? Here there is no, not that, that balance between the absorption of potassium from the GA tract, and it is related to the excretion by the kidney and the salivary glands. That is the homeostasis of potassium. And transport of potassium is a passive absorption in the small intestine and active in the colon under the influence of aldosterone. The clinical signs. We, as a practitioner, we concentrate more on the clinical sign, how the clinical signs of hypokalemia is there. Here, the animal is in the lateral recumbency. Already, you have attended a case of Downer cow. You are treated with the calcium, you are treated with the phosphorus, but still the animal is in the sternal recumbency or lateral recumbency. In sternal recumbency, the classical sign is turning the head towards the flank. As already told, in hypocalcemia also, the same clinical signs will be there, but you have treated already with the calcium, but the animal not responded to the calcium. Even after the calcium treatment also, still the animal is keeping the head turning towards the flank, you think about hypokalemia. Simple concept. Head towards the flank, even after treatment of calcium, indicative of hypokalemia. Sometimes some animals, when that is more, when the potassium level is very much less than 2.5, they will go for lateral recumbency. When you lift the head, the classical sign is when you lift the head, it cannot be able to lift the head. Again, it will go to the ground. Muscular weakness will be there. So normal potassium level is 5 milliequivalent per deciliter. When it comes below 3.5, it starts exhibiting the clinical signs. See the clinical signs, see the picture, the animal is in the sternal recumbency, the head is turned towards the flank, and this animal already treated with the calcium. During the calcium treatment, the animal voided the dung, urination is there, all it responded to calcium, everything is there. But when you pull the head, it will be straight for a few minutes. When you leave it again, it will go back, turn towards the flank. That is the classical sign of hypokalemia. So unable to support the weight of their head and commonly hold the head towards the flank. And profound weakness of lateral muscle. The lateral cervical muscle, the neck muscle weakness is the classical sign of hypokalemia. See this case also, the head is turned towards the flank, and this is when there is reduction in the potassium level below 2.5, the animal will go for lateral recumbency. When you pull or lift the head, again it will go down. So you cannot be able to maintain the posture. So these are the classical signs of hypokalemia. See this animal is the sternal recumbency, and the lateral curvature of the neck muscle like this, scoliosis. Some animals in the standing posture also, it will be having the turn, the neck will be turned like that. So you will be, some of the veterinarians or some of the farmers, they will say it got some injury and they will be applying some iodine ointment like that. That is also due to potassium related. See the animal is recumbent, but the head is turned. This is also here, the animal is recumbent, the head is turned sidewards because of the muscle weakness. Here also, the neck muscle is turned. You can able to see this. So these animals are already treated with the calcium and treated with the phosphorus, but not responding. But you have to think about the third option is the hypokalemia. So by clinical signs, if you are having a biochemical laboratory facilities, you take serum and evaluate calcium, phosphorus, potassium. Very easy to handle these type of cases. If you are not having facility, by appreciating the clinical signs, you have to select the treatment protocol. So the blood serum sample can be sent for evaluation. The normal is 5 milliequivalent. Below 3.5 milliequivalent needs a supplementation of potassium. So here the availability is potassium chloride is available as a 10 ml ampule. It is available from all medical shops. It is available as a 10 ml ampule. Is a human preparation is that each ml contains 2 milliequivalent. Each ml contains 2 milliequivalents. That keep it in mind. And you have to take more care on administration of this type of potassium. So the dose is 0.5 to 1 milliequivalent per kg per hour. So 0.5 milliequivalent, 0.5 to 1 milliequivalent. You can take it as a lower level, 0.5 milliequivalent per kg per hour. You have to mix it with normal saline. You have to mix it with the normal saline and give IV. How to mix it with the normal saline? In one NS sachet, you should not mix more than 40 or 50 ml of potassium chloride. Okay. So in one NS sachet, you should not mix more than 40 to 50 ml of potassium chloride sachet. And another thing you have to take more care is that we are giving calcium as a slow rate, very, very, very slowly. We are giving slowly. Rather than that, in potassium, you have to give very, very, very slowly. We cannot play in this potassium, with this potassium. When you increase the speed, immediately the animal will develop arrhythmia and it will die. So you have to take more care when administration of potassium IV. And you have to give it drop by drop. There should not be any much compromise in administration of potassium. You have to give it drop by drop. And before giving potassium, you tell the owner about the consequence. I'm going to give it IV. Sometimes untoward reaction may occur. Like that, you have to enlighten the owner. Then you start the treatment. Otherwise, if you are doing the treatment and the animal die, then it will be a problem. So when you are giving IV, you have to take more care. The speed should be very, very, very slow, and it should be the dose rate of 0.5 to 1 milliequivalent per kg body weight per hour. So any other remedy for that? I'm getting afraid for using this potassium chloride and IV. So in one sachet, I can use only 40 ml or 50 ml maximum, and I have to go for slowly means I have to sit there for 2 to 3 hours or 4 hours for a single animal treatment, and it will take a long time. Any other alternative remedy for correcting hypokalemia is there, is well and good. Oral administration of potassium chloride is also very much effective. In acute hypokalemia, for example, when it is less than 2.5, like that, if you are giving IV, then you are following it by oral administration of potassium chloride, it will be very much effective. Or otherwise, if you are not able to administer IV, you are not getting enough time or enough confidence to administer this, you are getting afraid of giving IV, you can give potassium chloride orally. So it is available as a potlor syrup, is available everywhere, it's available from the market. So you can give orally the same dose, 0.5 milliequivalent per kg body weight can be given it orally. That the dose of 0.4 gram per kg body weight can be given, or in the milliequivalent also you can calculate and give it orally, and it will be very much effective. So after giving potassium, within one day, like hypocalcemia, it won't get the immediate effect. So after administration, immediately the animal won't get up. It will take 6 to 8 hours. And the next day, you can see the animal will be in the standing posture and you will be feeling very much happy with treatment. So in calcium, immediate result will be there. Within 10 to 15 minutes, you can appreciate the result. Here, it will take some few hours. 6 to 8 hours will be there. The next day, the response will be very much good. The same time, you should not give excess dose. Some farmers, they give daily potassium chloride 400 ml for 2 to 3 days. So when you give it in excess, that will lead to hypermagnesemia, because potassium will impair the absorption of magnesium. So this is the lateral kink of the neck. So it's a case of hypokalemia. So whenever the animal is responding to your treatment, whatever may be, whether it's a hypercalcemia, hypophosphatemia, and we are coming for the last part of the session, I will tell you a few points before completing this. And whenever you are treating this hypocalcemia, hypophosphatemia, or hypokalemia, so you don't expect the animal to stand up its own in all the cases. Because if it is a fresh case, after giving calcium, the animal will get up. If it is a delayed case, then naturally I told the animal, if it is you are treating with more than 6 hours or 8 hours of recumbency, the animal may go for secondary recumbency because of peripheral nervous injury. It won't get up on its own. It needs support. So we have to lift the animal. So with the support, so with the some people with the pole and all, you lift the animal and keep it standing posture and massage the forelimb and hind limb, so that you can able to appreciate whether the forelimb and hind limb, whether they are maintaining the weight bearing normally or not. By seeing the posture, you can identify what type of secondary recumbency it has been. Then you can treat it accordingly, so that you need not go on repeating the calcium or phosphorus alone in the downer course. So for example, some animals after treatment of calcium and all, it will be exhibiting posture like this, hind limb being extending towards the toes, is indicative of obturator nerve paralysis. So these animals, they do not require repeated calcium, repeated phosphorus, or repeated potassium. So they need physiotherapy. So you have to lift the animal and keep it in the sling like this for a few days, and you can put the hobble in both the hind limbs, you can put the hobble and maintain it for a few days and give the supportive treatment. Then the animal recovers slowly. Okay. These type of secondary recumbencies, you have to treat it with vitamin B1, B12, and B6. Sometimes when you lift the animal, they may be showing this type of posture, that partial knuckling of the foot leg will be noticed. That is called tibial nerve injury. And some other cases, these are all tibial nerve. You can able to appreciate the partial knuckling of the foot leg. So this, because of this injury, tibial nerve injury, the animal will be reluctant to get up, and it will be always in the recommend. So you will be thinking, still we have to give calcium, and you need not to go for repeated calcium. Just when the animal becomes started taking feed, everything normal, you just lift the animal and keep it in the sling and treat it accordingly with B1, B12, B6. So this animal, so what I used to give, I used to this type of cases already treated and all. See the position. Now the head turned towards the flank. So you will be thinking about hypokalemia. So I will be giving potassium chloride orally. And I used to give tribuvate in 1 ns. I used to mix 30 to 50 ml of tribuvate and give IV for a few days. So I will give you giving 1 or 2 doses of potassium and the following treatment with the tribuvate. And I used to keep the animal in the sling support. This is a case of radial nerve paralysis. See, so a forelimb is extended. And this is a case of radial nerve paralysis. You have to treat it accordingly. It's a radial nerve paralysis. And see, the animal, when the animal is in the sitting posture, they used to keep the forelimb extended. That indicates a radial nerve paralysis. In this type of cases, there is no need of giving calcium at all. You give vitamin B supplement, B1, B12, B6 can be given IV. Don't give it in direct IV. You mix it with normal saline and give IV. Don't give any B complex preparation direct IV. You have to mix it with normal saline and give IV. And this is the sling management. The animal is in the sling. It is having radial paralysis. It will take few days or few weeks for recovery. And we have to tell the prognosis. Here you can see the elbow joint, dropped elbow. So elbow joint is dropped and dragging of the forelimb is there. It's a classical sign of radial nerve paralysis. Why I put this type of pictures? When the animal is in the recumbency position, you will be thinking, again, it is not responded to the treatment and you will be going on giving calcium. There is no need. That's why I'm putting this. And when you lift the animal will be showing this type of position like this. See, the hock joint is touching the ground. When you lift the animal, this is a case of hypercalcemia presented to the hospital. After giving a calcium, it become normal, but it is still recommends. So they have given going on giving calcium for 4 to 5 days like that, and they brought to the hospital. And just when you lift the animal will be bearing the weight on the hock joint. It should not bear the weight on the hock joint. If it is bearing the weight on the hock joint, it is a classical case of gastrocnemius muscle rupture. So you have to tell the prognosis. So when you lift the animal will bear the weight on the hock joint. So this is a classical sign of gastrocnemius muscle rupture. So this is another one case of a downer cow. So if you are going and attending this case, can you give calcium to this case? No, this is not a case of hypercalcemia. This is a case of oral respiration, respiratory distress is there, extended neck is there. It is a case of aspiration pneumonia. So that we have to differentiate. So aspiration pneumonia due to gel administration. So that we have to advise the farmer whenever you are giving the gel preparation, you have to take more care not to get aspirated. So this is a case when you are going to attend. So you'll be thinking it's a case of milk fever. It's not a case of milk fever. It's a case of septicemia. See the case. Respiratory distress is there. Nystagmus is there. Nystagmus is there. So it is a case of sepsis. So these type of cases need not require calcium treatment. They require fluid therapy. So this case already treated with the calcium and all, it's having all bed sores and all, and it is still recommend lateral recumbency. In this case, you can supplement potassium level. So potassium supplementation will work out, and this you can bring that the animal to normal. After becoming giving potassium, the animal become normal and it will be in the sterile recumbency. Because of prolonged recumbency, it's having bed sores. This animal requires sling support, then only it will become normal. Why I'm telling, many of the cases, if it is recommend for a long period, we cannot expect these cases to get up automatically of its own. We have to put a sling support and then only it will get up. So these are the normal reference values for calcium, phosphorus and potassium. So we can very well having a facility, we can see and treat it very easily. And how to differentiate the hypercalcemia and the hypophosphatemia, and as already explained clearly, we are treating a case of hypercalcemia, giving a milk fever treatment for milk fever, calcium is supplemented, the animal responded to the treatment, but it is still recommend you think about hypophosphatemia. So you are supplementing phosphorus. You are giving a phosphorus supplement, Novisac IV and sodium phosphate, inorganic phosphorus orally, 100 to 150 gram orally, so that it will be phosphorus deficiency will be corrected. And hypomagnesemia, the animal will be recommended with the seizures will be, convulsions will be there. And hypokalemia, lateral, even after the treatment of calcium, the animal will be, symptoms will be exhibiting lateral kink of the neck muscles or muscular weakness will be there. So you have to supplement potassium orally so that you can differentiate very easily by means of clinical signs. And after treatment of milk fever, some animals will get up and they will be always preferring the standing posture. So some owners, they will say the animal got up and they are still it is standing, 2 or 3 days it is standing. It is nothing to worry, just to give supplement, oral supplementation of phosphorus. In few days it will become normal because of afraid the animal won't get down. It won't go for recumbent. It won't lie down. Because if it is lying down, it will think it won't get up again. So naturally, it will be in the standing posture for few days, it will be okay. Other reason for standing posture for a long time, when the animal is trying to lie down, immediately the animal will get up, means you have to think about foreign body syndrome. That is a separate one. So the take home points, the hypocalcemia in regarding the milk fever, earliest attention should be given for a milk fever, and don't delay the case of milk fever. When it goes beyond that stage, it will go for death. So attend the case at the earliest and give calcium flow IV for a period of 15 minutes. Give half dose IV, half dose subcutaneous, warm the solutions and give it calcium. After giving calcium, the animal will respond well and it will get up on its own. If it is not getting up, you give a support that so that the animal will get up. When the animal is recumbent in a concrete floor or a cement floor or a cattle shed for a prolonged period, the animal won't get up. So we have to go for a support, sling support. In that time, the animal shows some posture that I have shown some videos that you can manage it with the sling support. Very easy to handle. And even after giving calcium, the animal started taking feed and everything normal, but still it is recommended you think about hypophosphatemia. So you supplement the phosphorus, injectable phosphorus, and along with that, oral phosphorus is very much essential so that you can correct the phosphorus very easily. And in hypokalemia, the animal is still in recumbency or the head turned towards the flank. Or severe hypokalemia, the animal may be in the lateral recumbency, muscular weakness of the neck will be there. You supplement potassium. When you are going for a potassium IV, without seeing the serum potassium level, don't go for IV treatment. Because if you are giving in a normal animal, if the potassium level is 5 milliequivalent, and if you are giving in a normal animal without seeing the serum potassium level, within 20 to 30 ml itself, the animal will die. So you have to take more care. Unless otherwise you see the potassium level, don't go for IV. Now you are having the serum potassium level value. If it is below 3.5, then you go for IV preparation of potassium. That means you can mix in normal saline, some 40 to 50 ml in a normal saline bottle and give it very, very slowly. You are not evaluating the serum potassium level. Only you are treating with the clinical signs alone. You have to give oral potassium. That is sufficient. That is also work well and it will be more effective. You give potassium orally, potassium chloride syrup orally, that will work well. Okay. So this is all the these are all the points I shared with you. So whenever you are going for potassium treatment, IV, you have to see the serum potassium level, then you go for IV treatment. Otherwise, you prefer oral administration. That's all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Sivaraman, for a wonderful, long, elaborative, and yet precise lecture. He is actually, sir, if you can close the slide, it will be better. He is one of the marathonists who runs a marathon all the time. So we thank him on behalf of the entire 2,700 veterinarians who are currently attending the program since the starting. Thank you, Sivaraman, sir. We have participants currently from India, of course, Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh, Nigeria, and a few from US also. So we have lots of questions, sir. Lots of concepts have got cleared up of people. Lots of things people feel that need a further clearance from your end. The first question, which most of the questions are coming from a younger group, the budding group, or a reluctant, or a group which wants to have a faster treatment rather. So they say that Blood and Henderson says calcium should be given very fast. Dr. Sivaraman says calcium should be given slow. So what is right as per our scenario? So
anything, whether it is a calcium or potassium, any component should be given slowly to avoid arrhythmia. So we have to concentrate on the successful of the treatment of the case. So any calcium should be given slowly only. So I don't know where it is mentioned it should be given fast. I don't know. Everywhere it should be mentioned as a slow administration to avoid untoward reactions. That is the normal protocol.
Dr. Sivaraman is rightly saying neither Blood and Henderson nor any other book says calcium should be given fast. It should be given slow. It should be in appropriate manner. So the next question says why calcium chloride is not recommended by Subcut Root.
Just an irritant. If it's an irritant, that's all. Calcium chloride, it's an irritant. So it should not be administered subcutaneously. That's all, nothing else.
Sir, any of the, we have talked about calcium, we have talked about phosphorus, we have talked about potassium. So people want to have treatment faster. So they say any of the two treatments that I can take up for sure in the startup, like people say calcium and say phosphorus, can I do that together? Calcium and electrolytes, can I give together?
Yeah. What is, calcium, so whenever you are giving a calcium borogluconate, you can give other components also IV, no problem. Only the thing they mentioned that some people will be using sodium acid phosphate as a powder, no, that we used to mix it with the normal and give administered IV simultaneously. That we have to avoid, that's all. Calcium and phosphate solutions alone should be avoided, combined, that's all. That too, within 2 hours only, that's all. Suppose you are giving phosphorus orally, no problem. Suppose phosphate solutions, you should not combine at the 2 hours period, that's all. After 2 hours, you can use, no harm in that.
Sir, does it mean that every case of calcium deficiency is also a case of phosphorus deficiency?
Yeah, almost all the recumbent animals needs phosphorus. You can give a follow-up for phosphorus. If it is a recumbent, you can go for a treatment with the phosphorus supplementation. All the donor cows, all the recumbent cows, naturally they will go for reduction in the phosphorus level. So naturally you can, for a follow-up, you need not go for either primary treatment. First you give calcium, then for follow-up you can administer phosphorus injections with the oral phosphorus administration. It's all, we have to manage the case, that's all.
So the next question is asking the duration of treatment of for phosphorus. In the lecture, yeah, I think you mentioned
Yes.
3 days should
be duration of the phosphorus. For example, you are treating a case of postpartum hemoglobinuria till the urine color becomes normal, then you have to go for the phosphorus supplementation. And after that also, for few days, oral administration should be there to avoid recurrence. That's all. That is regarding the postpartum hemoglobinuria. And regarding donor cow, till the phosphorus, till the animal gets normal, daily you can give injectables and oral treatment for 3 to 5 days. That will be helpful for donor cow management.
I think one question is coming in from Bangladesh. I think the writer knows you quite well. Is that in Bangladesh, we start a hypocalcemia treatment with the grinding of the teeth that we observe in animals. Is it true? Is it the right and the first
symptom? Yeah, that I already told you. No, grinding is not grinding of the teeth, that it will be like a chewing, like it open the mouth and you frequently protrusion of the tongue. That is the thing they used to tell as a grinding of the teeth. The early stage 1.
Another question comes up from few people is that, say we have hypocalcemia, which goes with low levels of temperature. On the other hand, we have eclampsia in dogs, which says high temperature. So could you please?
It's a frequently asked question from everywhere and every students and all know. Because it's a natural one. In bovines, the threshold for the neuromuscular junction, for example, calcium is required for the secretion of acetylcholine in the neuromuscular junction. That's why it will transmit the impulses. That is a basic thing. In boys, the threshold is very much increased. And in dog, the threshold is very much less. That's why in dog, they are getting, because of the neuromuscular dysfunction, they are getting the tetany-like clinical signs. In bovine, we are getting flaccid-like clinical signs. The concept is same, the neuromuscular dysfunction, because of the receptor, the acetylcholine impairment in the receptor level. The concept is same in both bovine and dog. Only the thing, the threshold difference, that's all. That's why we are getting flaccid paralysis in cow and tetany-like signs in bitches. That's all.
Sir, is there any technique by...
Eventually, when there is a drop in calcium level, the animal goes for subnormal temperature in cattle. Because of the tetany, there will be elevation of temperature in bitches. That's all.
Sir, is there a technique by which I can measure calcium, phosphorus, or potassium levels in the field?
Serum evaluation, by serum evaluation only.
Only that? No other? No spot other test?
No, only by operation. Otherwise, One thing, you collect the serum and it send it to the lab and get the result. Other things, you correlate with the clinical science, what we have discussed now.
Sir, another frequent question which comes, which has been clarified by you, is earlier, some 20 years back, people used to say one CVG bottle used to work. Today, even three do not work. So you already classified that, saying that if we are using one, maybe two, after that, we need to look at other diseases also. So there are a number of such questions, but just for your...
Yes, and the practice, the normal thing is for an adult animal, for around 350 to 400 kg, one bottle is more than sufficient, which is more than the 500 kg. Like that means you need another one bottle. That is normally used to give in the field conditions, in the routine treatment. One bottle or two bottles. Even one bottle or two bottles, when you are giving intravenously, it will respond to a treatment. So as already told, it should urinate, it should defecate, and it become normal. That are all the positive signs of response to the treatment. Even after, why I'm telling no, even there is no response, the animal is not at all urinating, not at all defecating. It's all, after giving two bottles of calcium also, it is still in the sleeping, like comatose stage. You have to reevaluate your diagnosis. That's why I'm telling. So many of us will be repeatedly going for next day, we'll be going for another day like that. The animal will be same like that, comatose stage or unconscious. We'll be giving calcium, calcium, calcium. That angle I'm telling. There is no need of repeating the same calcium. We have to reevaluate our diagnosis. That's all. One bottle will show whether it is hypercalcemia or not. That is the concept.
Sir, this concept of sling should be adopted for how many days? Because field has got its own difficulties. So there.
Yes. We can make it as a home makeshift sling. If they are having a sling facilities in the nearby area, nowadays it is available everywhere. They can have it and they can use it. Or otherwise, in the villages and all, they used to have the homemade or makeshift sling and all with the gunny bags or a pole and all, they can make it. And you have to keep the animal in the standing posture to avoid further complication for the nervous injury. So till it be have the weight bearing. So when the animal is having weight bearing, till that, you have to maintain in the sling. That's all.
Sir, there are a few questions. I think we'll put them on mail to you and we'll try to answer them, because a few questions are also related with our next session on ketosis, negative energy balance and all, which can be answered in the later part. So on behalf of the entire veterinary community, all those present here, we thank you, sir, for being a part of the session. It was a lovely session, but it was a marathon session for you, who kept on saying for the next 1.5 hour without taking a break, sir. So it was, and we know that you are a great clinician and a good academician, a mix of both. So on behalf of the entire people who are here, we thank you all. Thank you for being there, sir. And we thank all the participants for being for so long with us. But yet, it was a knowledgeable and a learning experience for all of us. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Nitin and the Intas Pharmaceuticals. And I thank my teachers and everyone. Thank you very much. Thank you.
As said earlier also, we'll meet next Sunday, same time, for a part two of the same, which will talk about the energy part and whatever is left over in production diseases for farm animals. Thank you to all.
Thank you.